Okay, so I was wondering, on line 700, God therefore cannot hurry and be just, not God, not feared then nor obeyed. And I was kind of wondering what you guys thought on, can God hurt us and be just, or, and if so, like, to what extent can God hurt us and be just? Kind of just got me thinking about that idea.
Wait, so the question is, can God be just if he hurts us?
Yeah, or like if he can, to what extent as well?
What do you mean, like, to what extent?
Well, like, there might be certain, like, let's say God can hurt us and be just. I think there might be certain boundaries that, like, how far God can go, essentially. If that's, like, relevant, I guess.
Okay. Well, going off of the line that he can be just, kind of, I think there is, to an extent, that someone can be just. Like, our parents can be just, like, when raising us. They have to, like, punish you somewhat if you do something bad. So I feel like in that way, God can be just with how he's not necessarily hurting us, but I feel like hurt doesn't mean like hurt so much, like physically or emotionally, more just like trying to get us to obey him. So by saying that, it's like he can be just to an extent, but as soon as he crosses that line where it's kind of almost more like Satan's power taking over, where it's like purposefully just to hurt us, then it's not, which I don't think God would do. So I feel like Satan is just saying that to kind of make Eve feel like Satan's greater than God, in a way.
Well, and I agree with that, too, that, like, God never, he doesn't hurt us to punish us. He's more hurting us because he wants, like, if we mess up, he's not going to punish us because of that. But he's instead going to see that we messed up and see that we're weak in that area of our life. And then maybe we'll go... We'll go through hardships and everything because of that, not because he's trying to punish us, but because he knows that that's where we're weak, and now he's going to try to strengthen that in us. So I don't think the punishment ever actually happens until hell. So we never actually get, like this whole earth, we're going to mess up and everything, but God's not going to deliberately punish us. He's going to try to help us and help us grow. And then if we just cannot, if we just refuse to grow and refuse to accept him and become better, that's when the punishment happens, is after death. So I think even if he does, like, hurt us on this earth, it's always is just, because it's not just to hurt us, it's always with a purpose behind it.
So, like, when you're saying, like, God punishes us to help us grow, this might not be the best analogy, but I kind of think, like, when you're training a dog, mm-hmm. and you might, like, say, like, if the dog does something bad and, like, you do, a, like, a tiny punishment or something like that.
Yeah. Or if a dog, let's say, eats the entire chicken off the table, so then you're not going to feed it its dog food because it already ate. Well, it's like, it doesn't need to eat that. That's the worst analogy I've made in my entire life. But, like, you know what I'm saying? Where it's like, it's a punishment, but to help it, you know?
And just trying to expand on this idea, you know, this might be what you're saying, that God, you know, judges somebody in order to help them, move them along in their spiritual journey. I guess, where do you think the text would imply that this is something for everyone? Because certainly Satan did not get this level of, God's going to punish him, send him to hell so we can help him along in his spiritual journey. No, it was absolute wrath. There wasn't a second chance. There was no, your destiny is eventually going to be heaven, so I'm going to move you along in this process. Is it just Satan who doesn't get that, or is it all humans? How does the text say that?
Satan's an angel. So, like, they don't get forgiveness. They just get, like, one choice of free will.
Well, I guess I'm not talking about free will. I'm talking about, and I'm not talking about forgiveness either. I'm talking about how does God's wrath play out, not just amongst angels and humans, but is there any type of subcategory that God would say no, I'm not going to help you along. This is absolute judgment. Does that ever occur before death, before a human dies? And do you think that falling, that Adam and Eve falling, being completely disconnected from God, is that just punishment? Was that trying to help them along in their journey?
Well, okay, earlier in the book, in book 3, I think it was, where God has his big speech, he talks about giving humans free will, and it almost seems, I don't remember the exact line, but it's something like, not free, then not sincere, true love. And it talks about how God desires a true relationship with his creation, so it's not necessarily an unjust punishment. So they are falling to temptation, and so they're going to be punished with death, but the death still, like as Sydney was saying earlier, like it's to help us, because now we get eternity with God in heaven, so it's not really an unjust punishment. Like, do you get what I'm saying? Like, we still get something good out of it. We get a relationship with him, so he's still wanting us to be in a relationship, and we're getting a more true experience with him than if we hadn't had the fall.
Mm-hmm. Can I jump in? I have a question. Because you're talking about how what was the last sentence you just said about the fall?
Without the fall, we wouldn't have the relationship.
Okay, yeah. And you were talking about death being like a form of like this discipline that God uses to help us. So I just had a question for everyone, but specifically to you since we were talking about that. Then, how does God use discipline before the fall? Before Adam and Eve ate the fruit.
You want me to answer it?
Anyone can answer.
Okay. Well, I think God's... God's discipline, I think God's discipline is that it's, like, God, like, relinquishing, like, him, like, being with you, and it's, like, letting Satan, like... I don't think God punishes us. I don't think, like, God hurts us, but I think when we're not with God, we're hurting. And so it's, like, God, like, turning away from, like, that's when you're, like, hurting, being punished.
Discipline is love. And that's how God said it. Just like in the Bible, it talks about how parents are going to discipline their children because they love them. In the same way, God shows that his love is authentic for Adam and Eve by placing the tree in the garden, you know? He's saying, if I didn't really love you, then I'd just give you everything you wanted. But because I know what's best for you, I'm going to tell you no, and that might, that would be what's showing God's real love, not. I feel like that's why he put the tree in the garden in the first place. I had a piece of scripture.
Well, without the tree being in the garden, then there's no chance for humanity to rebel. And like Dylan was saying, like, there is love, which is a form of, not punishment, what's the word? Discipline. Which is like disciplining us. But with the tree being there, it's kind of showing like, I'm gonna put this here, and if you really do love me, then you're gonna like not go after that, and you're not gonna go against me. But once they do, then he's gonna start kind of amping up the punishment a little bit.
Well, God is the Father, and if you look at Satan's argument and what Justin brought up, the line 702, says, your fear itself of death removes the fear, why then was this forbidden? And then on line 725, it says, and wherein lies the offense, that man should thus attain to know, what can your knowledge hurt him, or this tree impart against his will, if all be this? Satan, it seems like Satan is using God's justness and God's love for them to manipulate her. He's saying that since God is just and since God is a father, is a good father, that no matter what they do, God will still love them and God's not going to kill them. And that's what really manipulates Eve and turns her. He's using God's justness and God's holiness and his love for them against them, really.
It's distorting what discipline really is.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Going off of that, on line 7:64. It's Eve speaking, and it says, "How dies the serpent? He hath eaten and lives, and knows and speaks and reasons and discerns, irrational till then." So she, from Satan kind of using God's justice against them, she's kind of falling for it. And she kind of realizes, like, Satan has eaten and has, like, and he's still living. So my question is, like, why does this work? Why does Eve, like, fall to this? Why does she still think, like, oh yeah, I'm just gonna listen to Satan versus listening to God? Like, because she clearly knows God and has a relationship with him, but still chooses to go against him, even though she knows the actual truth, and Satan's manipulating him.
Well, I think Satan's so crafty in what he says that he's trying to convince her that, he takes all of God's words directly, but he stretches them so much to the point of it, like, being distorted. So he says on page 306, line 684, like, "Do not believe these rigid threats of death. You shall not die." And then, like, the fruit actually gives you life to knowledge. So he's lying, and he's basically going against everything God told them and making, like, again, like, shifting Eve's focus away from God to almost so that she considers this other option that he's presenting to her, that maybe God's not, like, not honest, or maybe God's not telling the truth, and it makes her have a choice. And Satan's just pushing her to choose the choice of evilness so that he can destroy her.
I don't agree with that. And so, like, to answer your question, like, it makes me think of the discussion yesterday on reason and Ben's kind of final point on like, having to focus complete, like, your 100% of your focus on God. Maybe it was because that Eve did not have 100% focus on God that it made it easier for Satan to, like, I guess, tempt her.
Well, and it even says on line 790, "Nor was Godhead from her thought." Like, God was not, he was literally not in her mind. And it flat out says that for that little moment that Satan was tempting her, she then stopped thinking about God, and she started thinking about, what if I had the apple, or, like, what if this happened, and then that's when her attention completely left God and went to Satan, and then that's when she felt vulnerable to being attacked and to her downfall.
On line 737, it says,
"Dim, and, like, your eyes should be so clear and all of that." And I was just wondering, I forget if it says anything specifically about knowledge, or, like, knowledge unknown.
"To her seeming and with truth." So I think that, like, backs up your point, Sydney. It says "to her seeming," that her focus, we see her focus start to shift away from God because, like, she's now relying on her own reason and to her seeming. So she's forgetting, like, the true truth, and she's starting to just focus on, like, her thoughts, and what Satan is saying to her seems like truth. And she's starting to rely on her, like, her idea of truth. And that's when, that's right before she starts talking and to Satan, and goes on and speaks once again of, like, how he's eaten it and he still lives. So she's starting to believe his lie, and she's starting to think, because she's thinking on her own, she's starting to think that maybe God has lied to them.
Well, and Satan makes, like, all this seems, he makes all this seem so desirable, like, it's, like, almost like it's a good thing for her to disobey God, making her, like, desire that by saying, like, 694, that going against it would actually be a dauntless virtue, that it's, like, bravery to finally break away from this, like, chain of being held back by God. And it even says, like, 307, 714, that it's death to be wished. That, like, even if she might die, he's, like, that's a good thing. Like, you want that death. And he's making her desire all the things she's been scared of for so long.
Kind of going back to the, I kind of agree with Ben on the reason thing, and going back to the line that Julia used, like I think yesterday, on page 293, on line 351, it says, "But God left free the will for what obeys. Reason is free, and reason he made right." So Satan, like, uses the things that God has, like, said is right, like free will and, like, reason, and he, like, manipulates them to, like, show that God says it's okay to, like, reason this, and, like, he, like, lets her, like, reason with, like, this thing. Made no sense. It made sense in my head.
Well, the answer is actually in, like, 753 for why Eve does this. It says, "Forbids us then to taste, but his forbidding commends thee more." This is goes to show that as humans and universally, God and Satan, or Satan, Adam and Eve, and all were commended even more. They all wanted it even more because they couldn't have it. Jesus was made king, and Satan felt like he deserved it more, therefore he wanted it more. And Eve, God told him, like, as the Heavenly Father, he's the Heavenly Father, he tells us not to do something, but they disobey. Like, him telling them not to eat the apple made them want it more. Just like as we, when we are told we can't have something, it makes us, something in us, want it even more.
It's human nature
to want something more, and it's bigger than us, because it's shown when Satan also, when Satan wasn't made king, he wanted it even more, which is why he fell, causing, it's a cycle. He is unhappy, like, misery loves company. He's unhappy, so he's trying to make Eve unhappy, and therefore destroying everything else. So because he can't have it, then Adam and Eve can't have it either.
Oh, yes. Wait, and that's, I'm excited. That's, for, like, first of all, that's directly backed up by, like, line 805. It says, "Others envy what they cannot give, and what you cannot give, you don't have." So you want what you don't have. So it's like, they didn't have that tree, and even though they had all these other trees, there's just something in them, like the human nature, that that one tree is what they can't have, therefore that one tree is what they want to have. And it's just like Satan, because, guys, because going back way to page 186, I know I quoted this yesterday, but literally Satan had everything in heaven. He was high in power, high in favor, and preeminence, and yet the one thing he couldn't have was to be the Messiah. And that was the one, of all the things he had, that was the one thing he didn't have, and therefore that was the one thing he wanted. And because he didn't get that, it led to this downfall. And because they didn't get the apple, they ate the apple, and it led to their downfall.
Got him!
Oh my gosh. Jacqueline, that we have to stop there. Do you have some finale? You pulling it together?
Finale. You can quit recording.